You're listening to India Bio Speaks, your one-stop resource for science, news and careers. Dear listeners, in this special episode addressing mental health in academia, India Bio Speaks revisits excerpts from a discussion that happened on October 9, 2020. This discussion addressed issues around mental health, particularly those that are relevant to early and mid-career faculty. Featuring Sandhya Visweswariah, Maitrayee DasGupta, Hansika Kapoor, and Imroze Khan as panelists, this discussion was moderated by Karishma, Kaushik and Mayuri, Rege. Enjoy listening.
Thank you so much, Lakshmi. Thank you, India Bioscience, to all our panelists and Mayuri for taking this on with me. Very excited to be here. And just by the audience poll you pulled up, Lakshmi, we see that almost somewhere around 70% is the target audience we are getting at with today's webinar on mental health, which is early mid-career faculty and PhD postdocs transitioning to faculty. All right, so I'm Karishma. I'm an early career faculty and Ramalinga Swami Fellow at University of Pune. I started my research group in 2018. It's been 2 years. So right in the thick of being early career faculty, and look forward to this discussion. With me is Mayuri.
Hello, everyone. I'm a DST inspired faculty at Rhea College and still figuring out this early career faculty thing myself. I apply bioengineering tools to study how genes are controlled. And so this is Karishma's brainchild, having the three-part web series. And I'm very happy to be part of this discussion because I'm learning a lot about this whole aspect that generally people never talk about, that we have, as young PIs, never been trained in. We've only been taught how to do with science. So I bring the perspective of the uninitiated PIs, I think, what I would like to say. So with that, let me just start with the introductions of today's panelists. First, we have Professor Sandhya Visweswariah. Sandhya is a professor at IISc, where she studies the mechanism of signal transduction via cyclic nucleotides in bacteria and the mammalian gut. She is also the co-chair of the Center for Biosystem Science and Engineering, and one of the handful of Margadarshi Fellows of the Welcome DBT India Alliance. A champion of women and young scientists, Sandhya has served as a student's counselor and was the first chair of the Internal Committee Against Sexual Harassment at IISc. She also mentors a number of intermediate fellows, and we are very happy to have you here today. Thank you, Sandhya.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayuri. Thank you, Sandhya. Welcome. Our next panelist is Professor Maitrayee DasGupta. She's a professor in the Department of Biochemistry at University of Calcutta, and her research focuses on symbiotic nitrogen fixation and plant receptor kinases. She has established a vibrant research program with 17 postdocs and students, and is interestingly a fellow of all three National Academies of Sciences in India. So welcome, Professor Maitrayee. We are in wonderful company, as you can see.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to introduce Imroze. He is a SERV Early Career Fellow and a DBT Welcome Trust in the India Alliance Intermediate Fellow at Ashoka University. He is an evolutionary biologist broadly interested in understanding how organisms adaptively evolve against or with infection and disease. Previously, he has trained at ICER Kolkata for his PhD and worked at NCBS DIFR for his postdoc. In spite of being an early career investigator, Imroze has already gained a reputation for being a very supportive and accommodating mentor to his students and postdocs. And we welcome Imroze also to this panel.
Thank you, Mayuri, and welcome, Imroze. Welcome. And our fourth panelist is Hansika. So, of course, I know Hansika through Twitter. Hansika works at the Department of Psychology, Monk Prayogshala, Mumbai. She holds a PhD from IIT Bombay. And interestingly, she worked in the area of creativity, specifically negative creativity, which she describes as how people get good ideas to do bad things. I would like to add how good people get good ideas, bad people get good ideas, there are many combinations. Anyway, she's a recipient of the Fulbright Nehru Postdoctoral Fellowship and affiliate of the University of Connecticut. She's a published author, practicing psychologist, and she works on behavioral economics and creativity. So very suited to our panel discussion today. Welcome, Hansika.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
So we'll get started with the webinar. We have sort of divided it into two halves. First is academia and mental health, and we'll have a few topics under this. And then the second part is how do you manage your mental health given these issues. So I'll let Karishma start off.
All right. So early career faculty, no discussion on their mental health. I mean, it has to start with new PI challenges. So let's just dive in. I mean, I'm going to dive in. Trust me. We can move on. And my first set of questions is going to be with Imroze. Imroze, no targeting you. It's just that because you're early career faculty as well. And you've just recently, you know, walked this path. So we move from a stage where we want this opportunity badly. We've worked towards it almost our whole scientific career. And yet when it comes on you, it's this overwhelming feeling of, this is all me now. Whether we succeed, whether we fail, whether we publish, perish, get grants, I get appraisal, the research group moves, it's all on me. So Imroze, how did you personally navigate this transition from being overwhelmed with the responsibility to actually start enjoying it? And what was the journey of your mental health during that time?
Well, thanks, Karishma. Well, I think this is a very relevant question. I think, I think this is a story of many people. I think, yes, I think there is no point in denying the fact that there is a lot of pressure. You know, suddenly you find, so until you were a postdoc, you were still working with a group and many of the logistical issues that you don't have to take care. And you just, you know, do your work and publish. So that's a whole different world altogether. But suddenly when you get into this new PI ship, I think everything changes. So suddenly from, you know, living under some sort of security with somebody else taking care of your logistics, you have to take care of everything. And with you, there are a bunch of, and suddenly you find that, you know, there are a bunch of people who are associated with you. Even the, and most, well, for example, in my case, I started with a new PI at a very new university or new institute in that sense, right? And when students join my lab, so there's an extra sense of responsibility, which is not about myself, but also somewhat to do some justice to the faith that they have shown on me. So that becomes a pressure. Of course, it is indeed a great thing. And amidst everything, there is the pressure of, you know, publish good papers. So yeah, I think it's indeed a very important phase of the life. But there are certain things that I usually take care of. Well, I don't know about, well, I can tell about myself what usually I have done, because at some point of time, maybe a year back or 2 years back when I was, I was trying to get funding from my labs and all these things. So there has been times when I used to feel that this is too overwhelming. And I realized the importance of to creating a mechanism of resilience to such things. You know, that's where I realized the importance of building a good peer circle, about good, you know, well, finding good collaborators, good friends, and also find an alternative way to, you know, relax in some way, because this cannot be the only thing. Of course, it's important, but I think this dynamics will differ from people to people. I try to take out time, you know, quite dramatically. When I think I need to get time, I'll just take it out. So without compromising any of the further issues. Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you, Imroze. I think the solutions will vary, but you very, very nicely articulated the challenges. You know, suddenly you feel you have to live up to a different kind of responsibility that people have reposed in you. Young people in science have reposed in you. Yeah. Their salaries depend on grants that you will bring in. And of course, negotiating administrative and logistic issues that we were never exposed to at all. So you find that taking time away from all of this, just thinking about it from a distance, has helped you do better in navigating these early years?
Yeah, I think so. I think having, as I said, the resilience mechanism, sometimes we have to devise on our own, because this is going to be different from, you know, individually, this will vary a lot. For example, somebody might like music, somebody might like, you know, traveling, somebody like to just chat with good friends. Sometimes good conversation helps. So that's the reason why, I think the present scenario, sometimes it just drives you to one kind of work. It just tries to, you know, tends to make you stuck to your office and in front of a laptop writing grants and papers. But it is so important to, you know, sometimes think, you know, well, we need to stop somewhere and, you know, just do something which we like to do. So this is how I am trying to survive. It's not easy. Finding the dynamics is not easy, but I think there is a compelling pressure which I try to tend to listen on and off whenever I can.
Absolutely, I agree. And for me, sometimes reaching out on social media to young colleagues across India and they narrate similar problems, it just makes me feel I'm not alone. Yeah. Often in the day, I forget that it's just not only me navigating this.
We should explore some of the other topics on this. So let's maybe ask Sandhya Maitrayee from there on the new PI challenges topic. Yeah.
So it's been a long time ago since I was a new PI, but I can still feel the angst of many of my much younger colleagues in institutes like mine and elsewhere, of course. One of the most important things perhaps for a young PI to think about at times when they feel a little stressed is, would I be wanting to do anything else? The reason for us to be in this profession, presumably, is because we love science and the doing of science. And someone who, you know, feels that it's full of problems and full of difficulties, maybe they need to sit back and say, is there anything else that I would be good at? Or is there anything else that I would like to do in life? And if the answer is no, then you're just going to have to grin and bear it, right? I completely agree with what Imroze said. The problem with many of us is, you know, our focus is so only on our work that we lose track of what's happening in the world around us. And we must have parallel interests. We must have parallel hobbies. The best way actually is to have a group of friends completely out of the profession. Yes. Because they bring you back to reality. Many times when, you know, you're worrying about some chemical not having reached, they'll talk to you about how they didn't have water in their house for 5 days. And, you know, that'll put you into some kind of perspective. So I think in all of these issues, young people need to find interest outside of their laboratory. And, you know, while it's very nice to talk to your peers and it's extremely nice to talk to people of your same age and perhaps at the same level of seniority, try and find yourself a good senior mentor, because that person, they would have been through this. They would have done this maybe 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago. They would have come out on the other side reasonably successfully. And the mentorship is something that I think young people must look forward to. Unfortunately, in this country, it's not considered something that young people want to do because they feel they're being talked down to. But then if that's the feeling you get, the problems lies with the mentor. So find another mentor. There will be people around you who will understand your difficulties and help you put things in perspective. I think I should stop here and maybe let Maitrayee say something.
Yeah, I think the way I am different from the other people who are sitting here is I belong to a state university and probably had started the lab with peanuts. I mean, it's hard to describe what I started with. You won't be able to relate to that. But having said that, there is a saying that poverty brings togetherness. So what happened is, right from the beginning to the end, my students have been with me, thick and thin. I mean, that is the culture in the lab. So because if you are trained, we are practicing science. It's a brain exercise. How can a tax brain be creative and a thoughtful brain, right? You can't. You may not have a reagent, but you have to have your brain absolutely active. You should be talking, you know, with joy about science. And that is what I always maintain. Right from the beginning, I think Imroze has seen me from the University Times. I mean, I have been friends with students all through because I talk to them and I make them think. Thinking is science, not only doing experiments. Some are not good in doing experiments, but they can think very well. Some are good in doing experiments, but they can't think that way. So I think when you talk about mental problems, it is the problem of the supervisors. We as mentors have to be able to manage our lab, our experimental, I mean the whole ecosystem in the lab in such a way that everybody feels that they are important. Everybody is accommodated, you know, and it starts right from the day one. So even if you are a small young PI, you have joined, like Imroze said, that you have to spend time with your students, and that is an exercise itself. I mean, someone is having a problem at home, you cannot expect that baby, that kid, to deliver in the lab. Impossible. You have to talk it out. You have to talk it out, make friends with them, and that way, you know, it delivers. So they work incessantly for 7 days, and then they don't come for 7 days. How does it matter in science? You have to be productive, right? Thinking. So that's the way I handle, I mean, right from the beginning, because I suffered. This has a beginning also. So this has the past as well. I knew what I had to do right from the beginning. Unless you suffer, you know, you don't learn. So I suffered before. So when I was a PI, I already knew this is how I'm going to be. And in a state university, like, you are anonymous, right? Nobody knows you. So you are not under peer pressure. Like, unlike you people who are from big institutes, you are under peer pressure right from the beginning. I was not. And so I could think, I could be slow, I could be steady. It's important. Wherever you are, if you have the opportunity to be slow and steady, it ultimately yields. I think that's...
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Maitrayee. And I will take off from what you said about creativity and being in the right mind space. And it's a great opportunity to get Hansika in. Hansika, you worked on creativity, albeit how good people do bad things or good ideas to get to bad things. But in our context, you know, when we are dealing with every day, that I can talk for myself, and I'm sure a lot of early career PIs will agree, there are administrative, logistic issues, research related issues, science related issues. How do you proactively get into the right space to make sure we keep thinking of the science? We are creative enough to think of good ideas to take this project forward. When you have the PRs and the POs and the bills and everything that needs to be pushed. Hansika, can you weigh in?
Sure. Thank you to all my co-panelists, of course, for bringing up wonderful points. I think they're absolutely relevant. I think pertinent to the question that you asked, prioritization and time management is a skill that I'm still grappling with, as is every other PI or senior faculty, early career faculty, whatever it is. But I think prioritization or figuring out what needs to be done when, making sure that you're not spending too much time on frivolous activities that may not really lead to fruition and things like that. And I actually want to point out the bullet point 2 in the slide, other metrics of success, is so very important to consider, because at the end of the day, your worth as a human being does not get reduced to your age index. And I think it's really, really important to remember that you're going to, and I mean, getting into academia or science is willingly entering a very masochistic profession and saying, I'm going to fail 9 times out of 10, and I'm still going to persist and be resilient and all of that. So it's part and parcel of our discipline, of our profession, rather. So I think making sure that we can keep that aside, yes, fret and fume over all of these aspects, but also, as you said, focus on the science. So make sure that there's enough self-care, that you're taking care of yourself, meditating, creating art, going on bike rides, if that's safe and permitted wherever you are. But making sure that you have that headspace to kind of deal with issues and concerns that probably you take from work to home. And right now, because that line is blurred, it's all coming together. So I think I would say prioritize and time management is.
Absolutely. Thank you, Hansika.
So listeners, that was part 1 of the conversation. We hope you enjoyed listening to it. In part 2 of this discussion, we will talk about academia and mental health, particularly the challenges around setting up a new group or a new lab. Please also check out several curated resources on mental health on the India Bioscience website. You will find a link to these on the description section of this podcast. Stay safe, stay informed, and stay healthy. See you soon. If you're passionate about scientific research, communication, outreach, and science education as we are, please connect and engage with us, and here are some ways that you can do so.
Visit our website at www.indiabioscience.org.
Subscribe to our newsletters.
Write for us and join our online discussion forum at discuss.indiabioscience.org.
Advertise jobs, grants and events in the life sciences on our website.
And feel free to contact us anytime at hello@indiabioscience.org.
Until next time, enjoy your science and stay engaged to enable change.